I'd like to do an example of a proton NMR spectral problem. This one's from an old test. It's from the fall 2010 test. And I'm going to use the 7-step method that I showed you earlier in the solving NMR problems mini lecture. All right, so our first step is we need to figure out what the double bond equivalents are in the compound. All right, so it's C6H14O. We take account of the oxygen, which is not going to affect the calculation, so it'll be C6H14. We figure out what this would be if it was saturated, and since it's C6, it's going to need 14 hydrogens. That's 2 times 2, 2 times 6 plus 2, that's 14. So double bond equivalents will be 14 minus 14 divided by 2. So we have 0 double bond equivalents in this compound. That means there's no rings, no double bonds at all in the compound. That's a good start. Next thing we do is we figure out what we're seeing in the spectrum. And what we can see is we see a CH2. And we also see this 1H broad over here. I want to explain what that means. So there's two situations you'll often see. You'll see a 1H broad, and that is going to be an OH or an NH. Now further, these are, and this will be a single peak, meaning it won't be split up, and I'll explain why in a second. Or you could have a 2H broad, and that's going to be a single peak as well. And that's going to be an NH2 group. Now when I'm talking about a broad peak, what I'm talking about is something that looks like this on the spectrum. That could be a 1H, or this one being a 2H. The broadness varies, but since I can't show this on this spectrum, since these are straight lines, I always write BR to see if this would be broad or not. And this can help us to see whether it's an OH or an NH or an NH2, rather than a CH or a CH2 or a CH3. Now the reason it's a single peak is because if you've got an OH and let's say it's next to a CH2 and then this CH2 group might be next to say a CH3. With the way multiplicity works, we know the hydrogens here can see these hydrogens here because they're on adjacent carbons. But these hydrogens here cannot see the hydrogen on this oxygen right here. It's almost like there's a wall there. And the hydrogen that's on the oxygen can't see these hydrogens, and the hydrogens here can't see this hydrogen. The hydrogens here, of course, will see these, but not this. But since this can't see anything, that's why these are going to be single peaks. All right, so that's a good tip for you to use. All right, let's look now at some of the other groups that we actually see in the compound. We've already identified our CH2. And since this isn't broad, and there's no nitrogen in the compound, the only thing it could be is a CH2. So if you have 1H broad, that's going to be an OH. Certainly couldn't be an NH, no N here in the compound. We've got a CH2, that would be this one here. Anytime you see a 6H, I would definitely try two CH3s before I tried three CH2s. 90% of the time, 6H is going to be 2CH3s. If it's a straight line, it's always going to be 2CH3s. There's nothing else connected to it. And then you've got your other one. This will be a CH3 as well. And what's important also about this 6H is that it's 2CH3s, and these 2CH3s must be related by symmetry. If they weren't related by symmetry, there's no way they'd be under the same peak. So we'll get to that in a minute, and we'll see how that applies to the structure. The next thing I want you to do is to see what we're not seeing in the spectrum. Everything here is stuff that we're actually seeing from the spectrum. Let's see if we can figure out what we're not seeing. The way we do that is we take our full molecular formula, and we're going to go ahead and subtract out everything that we actually see in the spectrum. So we've got CH2, we've got an OH, we've got another CH2, we've got two CH3s, and we've also got another CH3. All right, so we've got our C6H14O. We're going to subtract out everything that we see here. That would be 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 carbons. So we're left with one carbon atom. All the hydrogens are accounted for, and they should be, because we should be seeing every single hydrogen in the proton NMR spectrum anyway. And you'll see there's 14 hydrogens here if you count them up. Also, we've taken account of the oxygen. So all that's left is this C here. The reason this C does not appear in the spectrum is because it doesn't have any hydrogens attached to it. So now what we know is that the compound is made up of everything we see plus everything we don't see. And what I'm going to do is I'm going to draw out these pieces. I'm going to attach join points to them. I know that the CH2 has two join points because our carbon has four bonds. I know the OH has one join point because oxygen has two bonds. CH2 here will have two join points as well. And now we've got two CH3s. And another CH3 as well. That's everything we see. And now we've got the other thing that we don't see, which is a carbon atom. And that has four join points on it. And additionally, we know this carbon is not connected to any hydrogens, because if it was connected to a hydrogen, we would see it somewhere in this spectrum. All right, so now we have to come up with structures that contain all of these pieces and also obey the data that we're seeing in the proton NMR spectrum. So what we might do is just come up with a few structures and see if any of them match up to what we're talking about. All right, so the first one I might try is putting three CH3s on this C, and then the CH2 and the CH2 and the OH. So that's one possibility. Now I look at that and I see, well, I've got three CH3s connected to this C and they're all the same. So if that were the case, I should have a 9H peak somewhere in the spectrum. I don't have that, so I know that that's not the right structure. But looking sort of in that vein, I might say, well, I've got two CH3s here that are connected to the C. That's going to be a good starting point. Then I might say, okay, well, I've got an OH. And we can put the remaining pieces in a line off that carbon atom. Well, that one's not going to work out so well. The reason we know is because we've got a CH2 here that's a single peak. A CH2 that's a single peak means that it doesn't have any hydrogens on adjacent carbon atoms. And both of these CH2s are next to carbons that have hydrogens on them. So we know that this is not going to be the right structure either. Alright, so I still like my two CH3s connected to the C. And now what I can do is try putting a CH2 and a CH3 off here and put the OH, let's make this CH2 OH, and that will this looks like it will satisfy all the pieces. Now we can look and see if this is actually going to work out. And you can see we've got a CH2 here that doesn't have any hydrogens on adjacent carbon atoms. As I stated earlier, the CH2 here is not going to see the H on the oxygen over here. So this is going to match this CH2 here. Alright, so we can go ahead now and letter this. And I'll letter these A because they're the same. I'll letter this B, and then C, and then D, and then E. Now when I'm lettering these, I just have to letter every different hydrogen atom. So that's why these are both A's, and then we've got B, C, D, and E, and that will match up with the five peaks that we've got as well. Alright, so we know the two CH3s are the same, so that's going to be A, that's going to be our 6H right there for our two CH3s. The CH2 that doesn't have any hydrogens on adjacent carbons, that'll be B. And the other reason this makes sense is because B is at about 4 ppm, which indicates that it must be a CH that's directly connected to an oxygen. I'm going to show you this on the correlation chart, and you can see that around 4 ppm right here, that would be a CH connected to an O. I think this is a really good one to remember. If there's any one of these correlations that I want you to remember, it would be that one. But a CH connected to an oxygen will be around 4 ppm. It's really handy to have that information. All right, so that's our B. The OH is going to be C, that's our 1H broad. And now we've got a D and E. D would be this CH2, and this would be E, the CH3. Now if you look at the CH2 has four peaks. That means there must be three adjacent hydrogens. And if you look here, we've got a CH2, and it's next to three hydrogens. So that makes sense for that one. And this one here is E. There's three peaks for the CH3. That means there must be two adjacent hydrogens. So this must be it here. Remember, for multiplicities, if you see N peaks, there must be N minus one adjacent hydrogen atoms. So that would be the answer to that particular problem.